The government tried to erase their name. Nowadays, people call them Bengali, or boat people, because removing their identity removes responsibility. Few people know of the Muslim ethnic group living in the corner of Western Myanmar, bordered by Bangladesh and India. Their story is long, heavy, complex, and dark. Their narrative took a turn for the worse in the 80s, when the government took away their citizenship, and with it, their rights. The list of wrongs perpetrated against them is often concealed by conflicting agendas, shifting politics, and blame propaganda. Regardless, the words often associated with these people are torture, forced labor, ethnic cleansing, genocide, sectarian violence, and persecution. In the past few years, their homes and businesses have been burned or confiscated. Their friends and family members have been killed. Their mosques have been demolished or closed. And they've been evicted from their homes in Sitwe to live in the fields and camps in the countryside. But in defiance to the images of stereotypical suffering, the children play and laugh. Women crack jokes about their weight. And young men think about a future in which they can marry and build their own families. They hope for a future of peace where the government acknowledges them with citizenship and basic human rights. These people are not Bengali migrants, and they do not identify as boat people. They call themselves
Rohingya.
The Rohingya. And this is their story.
Muhammad Rafiq.
My name is Muhammad Rafiq. My age is 50 years old.
A spurt of violence in 2012 pushed the Rohingya into the camps that they live in today.
In the Rohingya camp, they come from downtown Sitwe before 2012.
Why did they move here?
Because they have been violent. They can't stay in the on the downtown Sitwe. So they need to move here.
Rohingya people from around Rakhine were forced to relocate from their homes in nearby villages and towns to the poor conditions of the camps for the displaced. Many of these people come from the town of Sitwe on the coast. The consequences of this transition have had a jarring effect on almost every aspect of Rohingya life.
Yeah, like, can you travel to Sitwe? Can you travel to Yangon?
No, we can't move this area. Only we need to stay this area.
I'm going to go to the house.
A Rakhine Buddhist monk shares his perspective on the situation. INGOs provide assistance, but are prevented by the government and authority structures from providing comprehensive and meaningful care. Because of the extremely polarizing atmosphere, the local Rakhine majority exhibit no compassion or understanding for the dehumanizing conditions the Rohingya now live in.
The Muslim people, before the conflict, Muslim people go around all over the Rakhine State, any the village, any the area. We go into, you know, the Muslim village, so we have the fear. Maybe they will attack or not.
The relationship between the Rakhine Buddhist and the Rohingya is complicated. Deep-seated fears have developed over decades of being exposed to misinformation and conflict.
If we go to the Muslim place, we are not safe. We have the fear. Because they don't trust, so we don't trust.
Exactly.
It's a problem.
The government, Rakhine people, and many of the population of Greater Myanmar reject even the name Rohingya. Because their ethnicity is not recognized by the government, they're accused of being illegal immigrants from Bangladesh with a recently fabricated ethnic identity, and they receive no civil rights.
I think, you know, the cause of the problem is the Rohingya, you know. I think they have to stop their creating the fake the story, the Rohingya. Because we accept them now, immigrants from the Bangladesh. If they are creating the problem, how can we accept them?
This is a tactic used to strip the Rohingya of their identity and delegitimize their presence in Myanmar. However, Rohingya have been coexisting with the Rakhine in this region for decades, if not centuries.
Bab, dada, por dada. Ya por dada. Bia gun das mane ro yur gi ezaga madu yi ezaga tu an por dada yi an por dada tunda za dada yi.
Mora bo. An dada dada. An ya dada dada por dada. An nana nana an nana.
Bengal lara ga sudara.
My grandfather born in the city.
Yeah, okay.
My grandfather, grandmother, they are born in Bon city.
But ask any Rohingya person about who they are, and there is no hesitation and no doubt.
I'm Rohingya. I'm Rohingya. Different name. I'm Rohingya. If they will kill me,
Rohingya. In the end, there is at least one thing everyone in Rakhine State can agree they desperately need. Peace. Or in Rohingya language, shanti.
Everyone wants shanti.
But to take the first steps toward peace, both the Rohingya and the Rakhine need to be seen and valued as human beings entitled to the basic rights of all humans. This will not happen without a legitimate path to citizenship for the Rohingya.
Allah,
Granting the Rohingya citizenship would restore their right to travel freely, work legitimately, own property, attend schools, and benefit from police protection.
Yeah, we have the, you know, humanitarian. Yeah, I love the human. Is it not good for them also?
There is no simple solution to reconcile this situation, but collectively, we can make an impact. What is needed most is global empathy and advocacy, and a firm mandate from the world to initiate peace in Rakhine. The Rohingya people need to have their citizenship restored. Simultaneously, the Rakhine people cannot be ignored. Solutions must be comprehensive. Promoting peace, economic growth, education, and human rights and protections for both Rohingya and Rakhine people. This starts with awareness. We must use our global influence to pressure Myanmar to put more resources into building peace in Rakhine. Since the filming of this documentary, violence has again erupted in Rakhine State. A recent UN report labels the current level of violence unprecedented.
They beat and killed my husband with a knife. Five of them took off my clothes and raped me. My 8-month-old son was crying of hunger, so to silence him, they killed him too, with a knife.
When we saw the military coming, my two sisters began running away from the house. They were caught by the men and slaughtered with knives. They were 8 and 10 years old.
I was at the canal fishing for my family when the army entered my house. They took my 18-year-old sister to nearby bushes and gang raped her. She was brought back to the house in critical condition and died the same day.
So what can you do? Tell someone. Share this video with your friends and your family. Tag someone who needs to hear about this. And advocate however you can. Keep the Rohingya in your thoughts and prayers. Their fight is our fight. Because we are all human. We are all Rohingya. I am Rohingya.